23-32. 1 Corinthians 11:23-32. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the new testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But then we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Here ends the reading.
This morning, I'm not going to preach a sermon to you. As the Lord helps me, I'm just going to throw some light on this Bible passage. I have preached many sermons before this Lord's Supper with different captions. There's always my desire somewhere that I just should expatiate this passage to you. Lost in me, the Lord constrained me. But just I'm going to read this passage with you. It may not be a very long sermon. Not 3 points, 5 points, 7 points, or 20 points. I'm just going to have this passage read to us. If you've got a copy of the Bible, kindly keep this passage open with us. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. Paul was a disciple out of time. He never seen Jesus. He never seen the miracles of Jesus. He never walked with Jesus. He never talked to Jesus. He never had a personal encounter with Jesus when Jesus was alive. He never saw Jesus died on the cross. He was not at the sepulchre when Jesus was buried. Before his ascension, Paul had never seen Jesus. On Mount Olives, more than 500 people were able to witness the ascension of Jesus Christ. And Paul, already was known as Saul, he was not one among them. When he had the testimonies of these disciples and Christians, of the followers of this way, he never believed it. He had no reason why he should believe it. He was against them. In fact, he was persecuting the church. He was the cause for the death of many saints, starting with Stephen. Even when he saw women praying together, as a Jewish zealot, he pulled those women by hair, threw them out, and had beaten them up. Such a chief sinner. Jesus, a risen Savior, revealed himself to him. The saving power of Jesus Christ touched him. His life changed. Jesus anointed him with the Holy Ghost. He obeyed the Lord in waters of baptism without no delay. He started preaching the word of God. He got strengthened himself in the word of God when he was staying with the disciples of Jesus Christ. And he started proving that Jesus, the son of the carpenter, the man of Galilee, from Nazareth, he is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God, God revealed in flesh. He didn't go to the chief apostles. He withdrew himself, stayed in the presence of God. God was giving revelations to him. One of the powerful revelations ever Paul had is this passage. This record is given by Matthew, who was present in the upper room in the night Jesus was betrayed. Probably Mark too had almost a very fresh first-hand information, because it is believed Mark was with a group that was in the Garden of Gethsemane. If we take that account for truth. My dear brother, my dear sister, we don't know from which source Luke heard this truth. Either from Paul or from the other apostles. Luke was an associate of Paul. But all these three Gospel writers, they give a vivid record of this new covenant Jesus was making the upper room the night he was betrayed. But this revelation came to Paul not by the apostles, not from the apostles or not from any other source. Jesus taught him, Jesus showed to him. He received this of the Lord. Very powerful. What happened probably a few years ago in that upper room? The same vivid picture was revealed to Paul. So Paul says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you." So it is not from Peter, or it's not from John, or it's not from any other apostles. What I have received of the Lord, that which also I delivered unto you, unto the church at Corinth. It was a Gentile church. They have also never, most probably never seen Jesus, his death, or when he was constituting the Lord's Supper, or we call Eucharist, or we call Holy Communion, or we call it the Lord's Table, or we call it the Lord's Supper. A year earlier it was called Christmas, Christ Mass, Mass for Christ. What are the different names that you can give for this? This sacrament, Paul was not a participant originally, but what he has received from the Lord, he delivered that to the Gentile church. It was a very powerful revelation what Paul had. A very vivid picture of what that has happened in that upper room. "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread." If you go through all the Bible passages about this constitution. It was the Passover. Most probably this Passover was on a, historically speaking, a Tuesday evening. As the church has made us believe a falsehood, Jesus Christ was not crucified on a Friday. Jesus said very clearly, 3 nights, 3 days, the Son of Man must be in the womb of the earth. It's very specific, 3 nights and 3 days, Jesus said. Friday evening you bury him. Friday, Saturday, one night. Saturday, one day. Saturday, Sunday, second night. So Friday burying Jesus Christ will count for only 2 nights and 1 day, which denies the claim of Jesus Christ that he is the Son of God. Jesus should be in the womb of the earth for 3 nights and 3 days. Most Bible scholars agree that Jesus was buried on our Wednesday. It was a Jewish custom. A day begins at the evening 6 o'clock. It's not the midnight 12 o'clock. It was an evening and a day. First day, it's an evening and a day. Night and day makes one day. So our Wednesday evening, Jesus was buried. That was the Passover day. It was custom that they celebrated Passover for 3 days. Lakhs of people, they all cannot sacrifice their Passover lamb on one day. So generally it is observed for 3 days. And the first day, all the common people, they gather in Jerusalem. They will sacrifice their Passover lamb. And they will celebrate their Pascha. And the second day, the rabbis, as we say, the Gurujis, with their disciples, with their shishyas, they will have some Levites. They will sacrifice their Passover lambs and they eat. Probably Jesus as a rabbi with his disciples must have sacrificed his Passover lamb on that day. So when he was eating that Pascha in the evening, according to the Jewish calendar, their high day, their Passover started. That evening that Passover started, that's the third day. In the third day Passover, when the day comes, the members of the Sanhedrin and also there were 24 priests and the 70 members of Sanhedrin and the 24 priests and the high priest, that lamb will be, that Passover lamb will be sacrificed. The last lamb that will be sacrificed would be the lamb of the high priest. That would be exactly 3 o'clock in our time. That's the time that lamb will be slain. When that lamb was slain, with that the Passover will be over. Before 6 o'clock, they just wash those place, everything ready. The doors will be closed before the sunset. And then the Feast of the Unleavened will begin. My dear brother, my dear sister. So probably in our calendar, Tuesday, the Passover lamb of Jesus was, Jesus and his disciples were slain. The sun set. The evening is come. The Jewish final Passover started. So on the day of the Passover, for us it's Wednesday evening, as the Jesus and his disciples, they are participating in the Passover meal. It was a regular Passover meal. The Passover meal was over. Jesus was talking to them about his death. When the meal was over, Jesus stood from his chair, changed his garment, put a towel around his waist, brought a basin of water, started washing the feet of his disciples, wiping it with a towel. It was very strange. At least 3 more Passovers they have attended with Jesus Christ in earlier. But suddenly Jesus was doing something they never expected. Jesus was telling them how he was going to die. A gloom ascended into that room. A gloom shrouded them. They don't know. They just imagine the situation. All of a sudden they had Guruji. He started washing their feet. He was telling them he was going to be crucified. He'll be scourged. He'll be nailed to the cross and he'll have that brutal death. And the shepherd will be slain and the sheep will be scattered. He says, let not your heart be troubled, neither be afraid. I will not leave you alone. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. I say all these things that you have assailed. You will be of good cheer. He says all these things and says, I say all these things that you can be of good cheer. As I said, a gloom, an uncertainty, darkness shrouded them. They didn't know what was happening. After the Passover, he did something very strange. He just took one bread, something maybe left over. He took one bread, he blessed that bread, broke it, and gave to his disciples and said, take and eat. I don't know how many of you know the significance of that situation. It was again a Jewish custom. It's good that you've been knowing it. When somebody died, maybe for a certain period, as we say 40 days or 16 naal, 3 naal, like that, 3 days, in some places it will be extended more. They will have mourning. They will have mourning. After 3 days are over, maybe somebody head in that family, a father died, maybe a periyappa or tata, some elder in that family, will gather all the family members. 3 days they are mourning, they are not eating, they are not drinking. They are the days of mourning. We read about that in the book of Jeremiah. Not today, I don't want to take any reference and all. So the elder of the family will gather everybody. He will take one bread, he will break it, and he'll give to everybody eat. After they finish eating that small morsel of bread, or something like our chapati, and I say bread, don't think about a bakery bread. Maybe something like our chapati or something, what we have for our Lord's Supper, what sister makes. So when everybody had a part of it, the same elder will bless the cup, and he'll send the cup around. And he'll say, drink of this cup. With that, the days of mourning will be over. What we say, Karmaji or Padina Radhanal Divyasesham, something like that. They had a custom. We call it Dukkha Nivirti. A Nivirti for Dukkham. A Nivirti, a remedy for their sorrow. They are sad for 3 or 4 days. Somehow we should change. We should come to normal life. So it was a type of a Dukkha Nivirti practice. It's that Dukkha Nivirti practice. One thing they say. Remember that person always. Whenever you eat bread, whenever you drink of the cup, you remember that person. Your father, your mother, who has done so many good things for you. She has totally sacrificed her life for you. You drank of her blood. She never thought about herself. She lived totally for you. Her joy was you. She slept for you. She didn't sleep for you. A very affectionate mother. That mother died. So they have a Dukkha Nivirti meeting. What they call a consolation bread. Aardhalinappam. This is called a consolation bread. In that consolation bread, the elder who conducts that meeting, he tells the people, don't forget your Amma. Don't forget your mother. Whenever you eat bread, remember your mother. Remember her love. Remember her sacrifice. With this Dukkha Nivirti, with this consolation prayer, don't forget her. Whenever you do this, remember the love of your mother. Remember your father. Don't forget them. Don't forget their sacrifice. Remember what they taught you. In most of the funeral services, I say this. If at all you have got a tribute to pay for this elder, pray for your mother. If you want to pay a tribute to your father, do what he has taught you. Do what he expected of you. That's the greatest tribute you can pay. So whenever you eat bread, whenever you drink of the cup, you remember your mother. You remember her words. You remember her sacrifice. You remember what she taught you. You remember her values. Don't forget her. Do that in remembrance of her. It was a Jewish custom. So after the Passover meal was over, when you read in the Bible, probably to save the space, everything is put together. When the Passover meal was over, the scene is switched over to something totally different. A consolation prayer meeting. A Dukkha Nivirti Kootam. The difference was, this Dukkha Nivirti Kootam is generally conducted after the death of a person. But here, Jesus conducted this meeting of consolation before his death. When the father and mother died, Some other elder will conduct this consolation prayer meeting or consolation meeting. He will break the bread of consolation. But here, Jesus himself, because there is no other elder, and he was not appointing any other person as an elder to conduct this, he himself conducted a consolation prayer meeting for his death. He himself conducted it. And he said a very powerful passage. Do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of my love. Do this in remembrance of my teachings. Do this to remember what all I have taught you. Don't forget it. Don't forget my love. Don't forget my teachings. Don't forget the lifestyle that I have shown to you. My dear brother, my dear sister. So what Jesus did, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take and eat. Take and eat. It has got a very deep meaning. In some families, father, mother, say three children or five children, they are very affectionate. Or at least they are without an open quarrel or anything. In some families, and most of the families, the mother would be the hub, the binding factor. The mother would be the binding factor. This very noble sacrament, I'm just making it clear that how it can be related to your personal life. Then you should understand the spirituality. A noble thing what Jesus did, I'm relating to what you can do it in your family and again related to your spiritual life. The mother, she's the hub of the family. When there is a quarrel between two brothers, she'll call the younger brother, shout at him, you don't know the value of your anna. Why are you doing this? Listen what your anna says. Good mother. You'll chide the younger brother and call the elder brother. Say, you must love your thambi. You should not do this for your thambi. You should help your tangachi. She'll talk to everybody. As the hub in a cycle wheel, as a hub in a motorcycle wheel, she will be connecting all spikes. All the spikes are connected to her, to that one mother. They all will be coming to meet that mother. They all will be laughing together. They all will go to some place together. They all will have a common meal. The moment that mother dies, the moment that hub is broken, the sisters, brothers, relationships will be broken. They don't meet together. They don't come together. That is the reason. When they break the consolation bread, they all eat that bread. Not only to remember the mother, to remember the communion that mother was bringing together. That mother is not there, family is shattered. It's not they are fighting or anything. They are not meeting. They got their own axe to grind. It's not that cordial as it was when the mother was there. So Jesus knew very well, it may not be cordial when he would go. Eat of the same bread. There is no greater love that you love one another. What's the big fight that who is greater among you? To fulfill my joy. If you want to be the greatest, be the servant. If you want to be the greatest, be the servant. The mother tells Thambi, Thambi, Anna, help Anna. She calls Anna, Thambi, help Anna. Be helpful one to another. Thambi, obey Anna. Anna, don't be bossing over your Thambi. Be together. After I go, don't fight. After I go, don't fight. So the elder, he takes the bread, breaks it, gives all the members of the family, not only to remember the person who passed away, to have the same communion, to have the same communion even after he passed away. One body. To be one body. So he said, take and eat. Take and eat. Earlier, in the school of ministry, we had a group of people. Those who are volunteers in our church ministry. Generally we send the plates around. Everybody will take and eat. That's a Bible pattern. But in a larger congregation, generally it is not possible. For one reason, somebody will take a small pinch. Somebody will take half of the bread. Some people have a great type of an idea that if I take a big portion of that blessed bread, then I may have more blessing instead of taking a small pinch. So it won't be possible in a larger group. But why Jesus said, or what was the practice? You take and eat. That gave the response, that pinned the responsibility to every individual. It is not only a communion, he takes it. Not somebody feeds him, he takes and he eats. He personally gives his commitment. He personally identifies his communion with that family. He do it in remembrance of his mother, his father. For what his father taught him. The values for which his mother stood. I take that peace. I take that peace. The bond of peace we were singing in that song. To have a bond of peace in the family. I stand for the values for which my mother stood. My dear brother, my dear sister. Jesus said, take and eat. This is my body which is broken for you. There are some people in their ignorance. Totally their ignorance. They would say, oh, Jesus told his people to eat human body and drink human flesh. It is a phraseology. We speak about somebody. He sucks my blood. He sucks my blood. It is rubbish, absolute nonsense. Some people think they are intellectuals. And when an intellectual could meet them, they could understand he is an utter fool. I saw one video clipping, and somebody, he was a Christian, and very interesting, his name was Simon. Now he has changed his name, something that could sound like that. He, in a very foolish way, he says, "Oh, Jesus said, eat flesh, eat his body, drink his blood." He was teaching cannibalism. Absolute nonsense. When somebody gives a phrase, "He sucks my blood, rathatha kudikiran," it doesn't mean that he bites, sucks the blood, and he drinks the blood. It is an idiomatic expression. If somebody is like another person, boy, it seems they are same gene pool. It doesn't mean they got the same origin. If somebody says, you are my daddy, you are my appa, immediately we can't retaliate and say, "Hey, what? You are blaming my father?" What rubbish it would be. It's an expression of love. Can immediately say, "If you are appa," means that did my father go to your mother? Nonsense. Third-rate nonsense. They call themselves rationalists. They are irrational. No disciple literally ate the body of Christ. No disciple literally drank the blood of Christ. If somebody can put this information and send it to that Simon, from this Simon you can do it. It is an expression. In the whole history, even when Jesus was alive or Jesus died, nobody literally ate the body of Jesus Christ. One fool says something, another 100 fools clap their hands. Nobody able to think. Jesus said, "Eat my body." You mean the 12 disciples ever ate the body of Jesus Christ? When they took the body of Jesus from the cross, were they eating that body? There should be a level for nonsense also. This nonsense transcends any human thinking. It's a very simple fact. Nobody literally, the disciples understood when Jesus said, "Eat, this is my body." Probably, praise God, the Simon was not in that meeting. Otherwise, very obediently, he would pounce on Jesus Christ and started eating his body. Biting Jesus Christ and eating his body and drinking his blood. Praise God, this man was not there. No disciple immediately pounced on Jesus' body. He showed a piece of bread and said, "This is my body." When you participate in that bread, believe that you have got fellowship with me. I am coming into you. My tata was a great preacher, a great servant of God. My mother used to say, after I got saved, started doing preaching, my mother used to say, "Tata avidanda unak vandiruk. Tata avidanda unak vandiruk." It doesn't mean a trans-substitution. It doesn't mean Tata has come into my body. It's the same mindset. It's the same type of a zeal for the Lord, for the word of God. His zeal was in his understanding. My zeal is in my understanding. The same nature. So Jesus says, eat of this bread, the bread that I have blessed, that you all may have the same nature. You all believe that you are participating in the same bread. The same Jesus is in you. The same Jesus is in you. Nobody was literally biting Jesus' body and eating. It is not the body of Jesus Christ came into this bread and they are chewing, enjoying the body of Jesus Christ. No, it's rubbish. It is the same fellowship with Jesus. It's the same Jesus. I want to become the same Jesus. My nature should be like the same Jesus. And there are two components. He took blood. It's not the literal blood. He was not cutting his veins and pouring the blood in a cup and said, this is my blood, drink. Drink of that cup, whatever may be in that cup. It can be water, it can be coffee, it can be tea, it can be wine. Again, in his ignorance, he said, Jesus taught his disciples to drink liquor. Many a time, when we talk something in our ignorance, we more exhibit our ignorance than our intellectualism. In their community, that wine is really permeated. It has got different degrees. What the drunkards would drink, it was a very strong one. And when it is diluted more, it is what the soldiers would drink. When it is diluted more, the common men would drink that. All are wine only. When it is diluted more, the rabbis would drink that. Earlier, in one occasion, why the other Pharisees accused Jesus Christ, probably he and his disciples were drinking the wine what a common man will drink, just like a coffee, any gentleman would drink. But a rabbi will drink that more diluted. Is almost like water. Even scientifically, plain water is not good. You go in Siddha Vaidya, they say, add 2 tulasi leaves, or to add some ziragam, or drink more, add more water to your fruit juice. It's a very simple science. So the rabbis would drink it more diluted, and women will drink it further diluted. There are 7 stages of wine. Okay, we'll leave a margin to his ignorance and we'll go ahead. He was not teaching his disciple to take tasmat charayam. Nonsense. Rubbish. When I say nonsense, I mean it makes no sense. He was teaching his disciples to take liquor. Now Jesus was not teaching his disciples to take liquor, that was a common drink for them. The drunkards will drink more concentrated, soldiers the 2nd stage, and common men the 3rd stage, and rabbis the 4th stage, and women folk the 5th stage. And the wine what Paul was recommending to Timothy, most probably the 3rd stage, what a common man would drink. They don't drink plain water. So when Jesus took that cup, blessed that cup, and said, drink. This is the blood that is shed for you. Jesus didn't die on the cross yet. They have never scourged Jesus yet. They have never pierced nails on his hand or feet yet. He has not shed even a drop of blood. This is my blood. This is my blood. See, I spent 20 hours, prepared a sermon. I came to preach. Some people didn't come. I tell them, என் உயிரை கொடுத்து நான் ப்ரிப்பேர் பண்ணிட்டு வந்தேன். இல்லாமல் போயிட்டியன் ஆஸ்க் எ ஃபூலிஷ் கொஸ்டின். இன்னும் உயிரோடு தானே இருக்கு, எங்கே உயிரை கொடுத்த? They are still alive. Why do you say, I gave my life and did everything? One day the mother says, you know how I brought you up after your father died? You are just 1.5 years old. I went for coolie work, carrying the sand, carrying the bricks, working in different houses, shedding my blood. I brought you up. என் ரத்தம் சிந்தி உன்னை வளர்த்தேன். சம் மதர் வுட் சே, ஐ ஷெட் பிளட் ஆஃப் டியர்ஸ், ரத்த கண்ணீர் வடிக்கிறேன். ஏமா, உன் கண்ணீர் வெள்ளையாத மாதிரி, உன் கண்ணீர் கலர்லெஸ் ஆகிற மாதிரி இருக்கு. எங்கம்மா நீ ரத்தம் சிந்தனா? வாட் நான் சென்ஸ் இட் இஸ். தே ஆர் தி எக்ஸ்பிரஷன்ஸ். திஸ் இஸ் த பிளட் தட் இஸ் ஷெட் ஃபார் யூ, ஃபார் த ரெமிஷன் ஆஃப் சின்ஸ், டு மேக் எ நியூ டெஸ்டமெண்ட், டு ரைட் எ நியூ வில். I'm writing a new will in the old will. When the blood of a lamb was shed, your will is returned. Your sins will be forgiven. For the remission of your sins, for the remission of your sins, this innocent lamb was slain. Peter knew that. John knew that. Every Jew knew that. Every Hebrew man knew that. This blood of the innocent lamb is slain for me, that my sins could be forgiven. This lamb is the propitiation for my sin. Today Jesus says, my blood for the new will, for a new testament, for a new covenant, little new will. Because I shed my blood on the cross. This is the lamb that taketh away the sins of the world. That you will have the propitiation of your sin. My body will be broken. That you will be healed. By my stripes. You've seen the miracles. Sick people are healed. All diseased people are healed. I die for you. My body will be broken, that you shall be healed. By the stripes of my body, I want to give healing to you. The life that I live with you will bring a sinless life and a sickless life. Your sins will be taken away. You will be healed. Believe in me. Do this in remembrance of me. Don't forget me. After I go away, don't forget my teachings. Don't forget that you should love one another. Don't be fighting who is greater among you. The greatest love, that you all be together. When you are together, the world will know that I am with you. The world will know that you are my disciples. The world will know that you are Christians. Whenever you come together, have this consolation bread. Till I come, you do it. I'll come again. Till I come, you do that. that you could remember me. The mother died. They got this consolation meeting. The head of the family is going to break that bread. One more thing I forgot to mention. As we say, testimonies about the deceased person in that consolation meeting. Everybody will stand up and say how important that person was to him or to her. My mother said all these things. I will not forget what my mother has said. I remember what my mother did for me. Everybody will say that. Jesus said, till I come, whenever you come together, you break this bread and drink of this cup to remember me. The word remembrance in Greek is more powerful. It's not that you have forgotten it. Bring it back to your mind. Nobody has here forgotten your father or mother. But one day, you are sitting somewhere and bringing it to your mind. Even I just think for a minute what your mother has said. Think about the days that you walked with your mother. You talked with your mother. What all your mother has spoken to you. How much is trying to bring a love between you and your sister, you and your brother. Today your mother is not there. You are not talking to your brother is not talking to you. Just remember how she made that kolukatta. Just remember how she was feeding you. It doesn't mean that you have already forgotten her. You are bringing it to your mind. Or you remember that party. You remember that tata, your grandpa, your grandmother. It's not that you have forgotten them, but you are bringing it back to your mind. So whenever you come to eat of this bread, eat of this cup, bring back to your mind what Jesus said. The values by which Jesus lived, the values for which Jesus died. Remember that to your mind. Remember that. Bring that back to your mind. It's a very powerful occasion. We are not going to eat the body of Christ. We are not going to drink the blood of Christ. None of us is cannibals. We are eating this bread. We are drinking this cup. We are not drinking wine. We are drinking this cup. Can be water, can be anything. When you drink of this cup, you drink coffee, bonnet, everything in your house, apple juice, or anything in your house. But when you drink of this cup, you may eat chapati, you may eat bread, you may eat burger, you may eat anything. But when you eat of this bread, bring back to your active mind the words of Jesus, the values of Jesus. Think about it. Give a testimony how that has influenced your life, what your mother has done for you. What is that you want to cherish in your mind? Bring that to your mind. The love of Jesus, what he has taught you, what you want to cherish, what that you want to hold as a value. Bring that to your mind. That's why Paul said, oh foolish Galatians, how soon you have forgotten Jesus who died on the, explicitly appeared to you as died on the cross. அண்ணன் சேஸ், தம்பி, ஹவு சூன் யூ ஃபர்காட்டன் அவர் மதர், ஹவு சூன் யூ ஃபர்காட்டன் யுவர் ஃபாதர். On March 3, my elder sister phoned me. Tambi, today I want to talk to you. Today is our past birthday. I felt very bad. I had forgotten that. I had forgotten that. It's not just forgetting a day. The elder brother says, Tambi, what all our amma taught us? What all our daddy taught us? How soon you have forgotten this? Amma lived for you. She died for you. How soon we lost our fellowship? You are not loving me, I am not loving you. Foolish Galatians, how soon you have forgotten Jesus who died on the cross explicitly before your eyes. My dear brother, my dear sister, Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. Now please listen carefully. Now Paul, with the Spirit of the Lord, he adds further. So when we eat of this cup, this bread, and when we drink this cup, we show the death of Christ. We explicitly manifest, it is true, Jesus died for my sins. Every cell in my body is the body of Christ. Christ lives in me. There is life in the blood. So my life shows Jesus died for me and gave his life for me. And if you participate unworthily, what is participating unworthily? If you cannot show Christ in you, if you cannot show Christ in you, Christ living in you, if you cannot manifest, if you cannot demonstrate in your day-to-day life the death of Christ or the purpose for which he died and the purpose for which you are eating his body and drinking his blood, if you cannot show the death of Christ, if you cannot manifest that truly Jesus died for you with all your lifestyle, with your love, with your compassion, with your simplicity, with your humility, if you cannot show Jesus died for you and the life you live now is the life you got because Jesus died for you, you are participating in it unworthily. As I said earlier, it will be totally nonsensical. It makes no sense. When you participate in this bread, you believe Jesus died for you. When you drink of this cup, you believe Jesus shed his blood for the remission of your sins. And in your life, the life of Jesus is not operating. In other words, you declare that all this is humbug, all this is tamasha, all this is a ritual, it has got no effect, it has got no efficacy. You got all fights, all quarrels, all hurts, all misunderstanding, all everything. It's not meaningful. The life of Jesus is not operative still in you. And what's the use of eating this? What's the use of drinking this? When you eat this, you believe Jesus died for you. When you drink this, you believe the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you from all wickedness. And that should be seen in your life. You should show the death. You should show Jesus died on the cross. The cause and the effect. The cause, Jesus died. The effect, I show that. The cause, Jesus died. The effect, I show that. It is seen in me. I declare in my life that Jesus died for me. My dear brother, my dear sister. What is participating in it unworthily? And you cannot show the life of Christ in you. That Jesus died for you. You are participating unworthily. And if you don't participate, you don't have any fellowship. In remembrance of the mother, a consolation meeting is organized. A brother living in the same street, in the same city, are nearby. He doesn't want to come because he's not very happy with the Annan. He's not happy with the Periyappa. He doesn't want to come. He's not very happy with the family. He doesn't want to come for the common meal. So they say, he has got no relationship with us. He has severed his relationship with us. That's in the Old Testament we read. When somebody doesn't participate in the Passover, he shall be cut off from the congregation. He shall be cut off from the congregation. And Jesus said, if you don't eat my body, if you don't eat my flesh, you got no fellowship with me. You got no fellowship with me. My dear brother, my dear sister, they are very powerful and very reasonable in this teaching in the Roman Catholic Church. If somebody doesn't participate in the Holy Communion whenever that is organized, he has got no part with that church. There will be no Christian funeral for him, no marriage for him. This is not just a fellowship with Christ, fellowship with his family. So when we participate, examine ourselves. It's not that pastor should examine you. You examine yourself that you stand for the values what Jesus taught you. Are you able to show the life of Christ in you? Are you able to manifest truly Jesus died for your sins and you have got the remission of your sins because the blood of Jesus Christ was shed? Examine yourself whether you have got really fellowship with the saints, with that congregation, whether we are worthy to eat that common bread, worthy to drink that common cup in this festival. Not just a sacrament, it's a declaration. Examine yourself and don't walk away. Examine yourself and participate. Don't examine yourself and you lack something and don't walk away. If you walk away, you don't have any fellowship with Jesus or with his saints. Participate. If we judge ourselves, we will not be condemned. If I know what's right, what's wrong, when I do the right thing, nobody is there to condemn me. When we do wrong, God chastens us that we should not be condemned with the world in the time of last judgment. In the time of your judgment, you should not be condemned with the world. It's good that our sins are revealed before time. It's good that if we could help somebody, if we could correct somebody. If we don't correct that person, if that sin is not corrected, maybe at the time God corrects, He may chastise us. There may be a chastisement, I don't want to call it a punishment. There may be a type of a pain. But it's good. We get corrected. We get corrected before we could stand before the seat of judgment. My dear brother, my dear sister, this bread, this cup, you are not eating anybody's body, you are not drinking anybody's blood. You are doing it in remembrance of Jesus. This is the time. Remember the values of Jesus Christ. What Jesus Christ has taught you. Your early love. The love that you had by the time that you got saved. The burning desire to read the Word of God, to spend hours in prayer, the love for attending the church services. Remember your early love. Remember from where you had fallen. If you repent and do the things what you are doing earlier, the Lord will bless you. Show the death of Christ in your life. Show the death of Christ in your life. And participate. Right now, we all stand to our feet solemnly. Sister Prabhi, Aarti play that last hymn. Orchestra, I love that you play it very solemnly. Jesus. Try to join and sing. And straight away, we'll be moving to the Lord's Supper. And we shall have a sowing time later. As sister singing this hymn, possible joy, remember Jesus. Remember your early love. Remember the time that you are spending in prayer. If possible, shed a few drops of tears. Wash his feet with your tears. Wipe his feet with your hair. Let that love touch you. Show the death of Christ in your life. Behold the Lamb that takes away our sin.
Behold the Lamb who bears the sins away, slain for us. The promise made on who come in faith, I forgive. the body of my Savior, Jesus Christ, died for you. Eternal remember the words that He wrote, that brings us life, pay the price to me. And to remember,